This is a National Arts Center podcast. Find more great NAC podcasts on the Performing Arts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free.
In days of yore, before the advent of pop groups and folk singers and the resulting generation of guitar-playing wannabes, most kids wanted to play either the drums or the trumpet. The reasons are obvious. Both make a lot of noise and attract a great deal of attention. Not always positive, but it's always nice to be the center of attention. Trumpets, it must be said, always get to play the tune, so the added glamour becomes irresistible, especially if you are attracted by the brass mystique. French horn is a bit too subtle and difficult for most young budding musicians. The trombone requires long arms and tact. And the tuba, despite its obvious importance as the root of all good, is too heavy, besides being a magnet for casual hooliganism. So the trumpet wins. It's not fair, but there it is. It was ever thus. Gabriel and Joshua provide impeccable ancestry. Never mind that the Latin word for trumpet is tuba. Of course, trumpet playing comes with a price. You don't get to sit around backstage with the low brass players for half the concert, improving your mind by reading classics, studying the stock market, or learning a new language. No, you have to be out there playing every piece, from Bach to whatever was written yesterday morning. There's always a trumpet part. When brass players begin to play, it seems fairly straightforward, but once we begin to develop and learn what is required to play in an orchestra, it soon becomes much more complicated. All brass players have to learn to play instruments built in different keys and to transpose into different keys and clefs, sometimes many times in the same piece. Trumpets, as usual, enjoy the greatest variety, being built in or having to play in every key. Some would say that's because of their star status. They should have to work harder than the rest of us anyway. But it's possible to have some sympathy for them, up to a point. I must say that some of my best friends are trumpet players, and for today's podcast, I've invited two of the best in both categories: the National Arts Center Orchestra's trumpet players, Karen Donnelly and Stephen Van Gulik, to share their thoughts on what it takes to be a successful trumpet player. I'd like to begin by playing the opening of Mahler's Fifth Symphony that we played a couple of years ago with Pinchas Zukerman. Okay, Karen, how did you get into orchestral playing, and what are the present requirements for a successful first trumpet player in a major orchestra?
Oh, gosh. Well, hopefully the short, long story is that I got into orchestral trumpet playing. I actually played in an orchestra for the first time when I was in my second year of university. I had little or no exposure to classical music, officially classical music before that. you know. I played in my high school band, so that's my background band, wind band.
So you started out playing B-flat trumpet, right?
B-flat trumpet, and then, you know, it was kind of, you know, I just had my mind blown, really. Like, I'd all this music, and I remember hearing Schumann Symphony No. 2, the opening of it for the first time, and thinking, oh, this is the most beautiful thing I've ever heard. And if this is there, out there in the world, what else is there for me to discover? So that was kind of the start. And then I realized I was woefully underprepared, and I pretty much say that every day. But anyway, so yeah, I only owned a B-flat trumpet, so I had to get all the right tools, as my teacher used to say, and learning how to use the tools. So, but it was definitely challenging to get used to transposing, because we generally play the C trumpet, the trumpet in the key of C, and then transpose the parts that are written. So we either play up a tone or down a tone if it's in D, or an E-flat, whatever key it's written for. So,
how long does that take to learn? I mean, we have to learn different tuba keys, you know, F, E-flat, B-flat, and C, but you have to learn every key. How long does it take?
Well, every key. It takes a while. It takes a few years, I would say, you know, in when you're in school, to become really affluent. I mean, honestly, I mean, there's still some notes that are funky to read in various keys, you know, like double flats or E sharp.
So how do you have to adjust your sound from playing in a band to playing in an orchestra? I mean, you had a pretty good teacher in Jim Thompson, right?
Yeah, I had two great teachers at McGill, where I did my master's, Bob Early and James Thompson of the Montreal Symphony at that time. You know, the big, I would say, adjustment coming from a concert band in school to an orchestra is you're playing by yourself. You're not with three other people on the same part. So it's very, there's a lot of individual responsibility. And so the sound, you're the only person playing that part that has to project over this big, huge orchestra, you know. And when you're playing first trumpet, which is what I generally do, you know, you have to be leading the whole, the trumpet section, the brass section, and at lots of times, the whole orchestra. So that takes some physical preparation. And physical for the chops, physical for your actual body, you know. So, you know, conditioning is very important for on the trumpet, but also away from the trumpet.
You have to be strong and flexible at the same time.
Yeah.
Well, we've just done 3 weeks of a tremendous variety of music. First week of the season, probably the most adventurous first 3 weeks we've done in many years. And lots of different kinds of styles, symphonic style. We've done a bit of jazz. We've done some chamber music. How do you sort yourself out to do that? How do you organize the section? How do you work out who's playing what and so forth?
Well, yeah, that's something interesting. And I think people wonder, you know, they sometimes ask me, where'd you go? What happened? You weren't playing that concert. So there is the physical demands. So if a program is very demanding, and yes, it was very exciting playing all of that music. There's a balance in preparation before we get to the first rehearsal. So, you know, like looking at the kind of equipment I'll play, sometimes I'll adjust mouthpiece, kind of rarely, but sometimes, you know, what kind of mute is required. Sometimes we play, like on this festival, the Roaring Twenties, I played some things on the B-flat trumpet, which I don't do that often in orchestra. But it was written for that instrument. It was in the key of B-flat, and it just seemed to lie physically easier on the B-flat trumpet. So, you know, Steve and I talked about it, and if something is a little easier or manageable and also gives a really quite an authentic sound, too, like, or approach. So, but then, So there's that. So that preparation is beforehand. But then there's also the actual physical aspect of it's not always only about getting through the concert. It's about getting through the week, getting through the 2 or 3, however many days you have of rehearsal. You know, I often think, oh, I could get through the concert playing every single piece, no problem. I just don't want to get through the week of having to play every single piece and then arrive at 8 p.m. at the concert and feel tired.
And then you have to practice as well, of course.
Yeah. So that's why it's great to have super colleagues like Steve and, you know, whoever else comes in to help us out like lots of times it's great that if there's a concerto or something that's a bit lighter that I will take off and the other colleagues will play. And it's great for them to, you know, have the challenge of playing, you know, an interesting piece. And it's great for me to not physically have to be involved in that process. So, yeah, I can, while they're rehearsing, say, for example, the cello concerto we did, the Elgar, you know, I was in the backstage, one of the practice rooms we have here, and, you know, working on my parts for the following week, which were pretty demanding and lots of notes. And so it's great to have the good support in the section and from my colleagues. And
have a also chance to, have a chance to play a variety between you as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, you talked about bands. Steve, our second trumpet player, grew up playing in a Salvation Army band, and I'd like to play an example of brass band cornet playing now.
That brings me back. Wow.
So you started out playing in Salvation Army bands. Could you describe how you developed as a cornet player and then as a trumpet player? Who were your big role models?
Well, I started playing the cornet at the age of 8. It's sort of what every kid did in the Salvation Army. It seemed like the natural thing to do. And I studied with my uncle, Ken Moore, who was the music director of the RCMP band in town and also was a fantastic trumpet player. Unfortunately, we got the chance to play together a couple of times, but he didn't play very much when I was studying with him. I studied with him for a long time, played cornet, and the track you just heard was basically everything I listened to and everything I identified with until I was maybe 14 or 15 years old and joined the Ottawa Youth Orchestra. And that's, I auditioned for the Youth Orchestra on cornet. Finally got a trumpet, I think, sometime in my first year with the Ottawa Youth Orchestra. And that's when sort of the door of orchestral trumpet playing sort of was open to me, and I realized there was more to do on the instrument than just play in brass bands and play cornet solos. So, yeah.
So how do you make the transition? I mean, cornet's easier to play than trumpet, isn't it, physically?
Well, yeah, I think one of the advantages of starting on cornet is that, and you can sort of hear it in the clip, even though it is very virtuosic, I think there's something sort of introvert about the approach to the instrument that maybe isn't so much present with the trumpet, in that the trumpet is sort of a, you know, I am here.
More aggressive.
Yeah, maybe. And not everybody approaches the instrument like that. But I think that initially with the cornet, what you're trained to do, you know, especially in the Salvation Army bands, is blend in with at least 4 or 5 other people in your section and then blend with the 35 people in your band. And mm-hmm. no one is to stick out. And I think that sort of upbringing, I think it helps tremendously in sort of blending, with orchestras and whatnot. But then you sort of have to start identifying what you need, the skills you need to absorb and add when playing in an orchestra. And Karen put it perfectly that there are times when you need to blend with other musicians, but then you are playing one on a part and you need to figure out you know, when to sort of dominate the sound and when not to dominate the sound, either as an individual on the trumpet or as, you know, a trumpet section. I feel very fortunate to have a good colleague in Karen that we can sort of work together.
How do you sort out vibrato, leaving it out, putting it in?
That's a subject that I think is sort of not talked about very much, and it's something that's hopefully felt on stage. I would say generally that's up to the first trumpet player and not so much up to a section trumpet player. I'd like to think I try to lay down something that the first trumpet player can play off of.
Mm-hmm.
And that's sort of the, I would say, 9 times out of 10, that's the approach. So,
you know, going back to bands, the golden age of trumpet and cornet soloists was really the golden age of bands too, I think. And there are fewer bands around now, so therefore, as a result, I think that there are fewer trumpet and cornet soloists. One of the biggest soloists I know that your uncle was a big fan of, and myself when I was young, was Rafael Mendez. I'd like to play a clip of him now. So Mendez uses quite a bit of vibrato as well. It's a very bravura style of playing. How do you approach solo playing versus orchestral playing from that standpoint?
Well, and I think that's the perfect point of, like, I grew up playing some Rafael Mendez solos, but whenever we approached those solos with my uncle working on them, that it was a different beast than the cornet solos, in that you had to bring this extroverted virtuosity to it. And with the articulation, I think the way Rafael Mendez articulated, which was sort of unlike anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
The quality of his tone and obviously the vibrato that was there was certainly different than anything I had heard before.
Now, I know that your favorite orchestral trumpet player, with apologies to Karen.
Oh, yes.
Is Phil Smith.
Yeah. See, we Steve and I have that in common.
Yes, there you go.
He's my favorite trumpet player, too.
Yeah,
I mean,
and Karen
Steve
is mine. Yeah,
yes.
And so we can...
But we both admire Phil Smith, of course.
Now, Phil Smith grew up in the Salvation Army. And let's hear a brief clip of Phil Smith. This is the promenade from Pictures at an Exhibition. Now, Phil grew up in the Salvation Army, played lots of cornet. Someone told me once that he actually warms up on cornet quite often. Could you enlarge on that?
Yeah, I've had, you know, small opportunities to to sort of pick his brain about this stuff. But yeah, he grew up slightly similarly to me. His father was a fantastic cornet player. And what's interesting is that I feel like later on in his career, he actually played quite a few of the cornet solos on trumpet later on in his career because he felt like he was more familiar with the trumpet later on in his career. But I know earlier on he would play a lot of it on cornet. And what's interesting about him is he could sort of bring a bit of cornet style to the orchestra, but also bring a bit of trumpet style to the cornet solos, which not very many people did or do. And he'd also admit, you know, very easily that that he felt that there were more sort of genuine cornet soloists around than him, and that they sort of maybe brought that more authentic cornet interpretation to the solos. But nonetheless, he was somebody who could sort of bridge the gap, play with brass bands, play with orchestras, and sort of be familiar with both genres very easily.
One of the things I'm kind of getting at here is I think some of the old style first trumpet players like Gil Johnson, Bud Herseth, they could turn on that vibrato, that kind of big band vibrato every once in a while. For instance, when you play something like Italian opera, you know, or Spanish music or whatever, every once in a while they just kind of lay it down a little bit, perhaps even overdo it a bit. But it certainly it gives you a sense that there was a style that was sort of informing the brass section of the orchestra. Do you think that style is now obsolete, or do you think there's still a place for it?
I don't think it's obsolete, and I think it's changed a little bit. I think especially first trumpet players, and Karen is amazing at this stuff, is when we have to play pop shows, she can bring that so easily and so naturally that, you know, Jack Everly loves it, and you know, any pops conductor, and you know, any one of our colleagues loves it too. And it's something that, yeah, that Herseth and Phil Smith and these people not only can bring, but I think nowadays are expected to bring to the job, because the job maybe requires more of that. But certainly, yeah, you can hear with different individual players their sort of influences, that Herseth definitely had influence of sort of, let's say, commercial or show trumpet players. Mm-hmm. And he could turn that on when he needed to. And Phil could bring that as well. But it was, again, maybe more sort of...
understated, perhaps?
Yeah, understated and sort of introvert, you know, cornet style to it, as opposed to the show trumpet player style. So
we've established that you have to play a lot of different styles. Let's hear a couple of different styles, and we'll respond to them as they come up. The first one is sort of quintessential trumpet playing of a specific type, and that is Brandenburg II, which every trumpet player is terrified of playing. We all have our favorites. Tuba players don't like playing Bidlow, and some trumpet players don't like playing Brandenburg II. Here's perhaps one of the reasons why not. That was George Eskdale, and that was the very first recording ever made of Brandenburg II in 1935, played on an F trumpet.
That's impressive.
Cool.
Comments?
I thought it was interesting you said that you know, I haven't had the opportunity of performing the piece, and I'm actually not scared of playing it at home when everything's going fine. I am absolutely terrified of not only performing it, but being in a city or in an orchestra where they're going to perform it and I don't, and the person getting sick. I'm even terrified of terrified of that. But I sort of feel like if I ever did attempt to perform it, I'd like it to happen in a rural school gymnasium in front of about 20 kids that are sitting 100 feet away. That would sort of be my ideal first crack at it.
Now, you both have to play piccolo trumpet from time to time. You wouldn't play an F on that if you had to. If push came to shove, you'd play a piccolo B flat, wouldn't you?
Probably.
Yeah. With the advancement of instrument making, it's like the first piccolo trumpets were not great. Mm-hmm. They were very small and very tight and very terrible valves, and you know, and so
it's a miracle you can get through something like that on the equipment that he was using at the time.
Oh, probably. even the best equipment today, it seems like a miracle to me. Yeah. I mean most of the Baroque repertoire we use piccolo trumpet, most of the, like, you know, almost exclusively, right? And most of it is absolutely within the grasp of your average trumpet player. But this particular piece lies about a third higher than most of the repertoire of Bach and Handel, and it often uses a specialist, you know, someone who's just particularly gifted in that extreme high.
I mean, most of the good piccolo players, the really good piccolo players, don't play the big trumpets so well, I think. Is that a fair assessment?
Well, I think that may have been the case a few decades ago.
Yeah.
But I think nowadays...
There's great players out
yeah,
there. That was definitely the case. Totally agree. Yeah. Like a couple generations ago, one generation ago.
Mm-hmm.
And we all know of, like, you know, great sort of established principal trumpet players in big orchestras that have... you know, that don't want to play it.
It's in their contracts. They don't play it.
Yeah.
It just is it's a whole nother beast, like Steve says, you know. It's like it's an immense undertaking in terms of preparation. And
I think it goes to what Karen said before. I mean, that it's not just can I play it? It's can I play it
on that
in a
day.
Week, or in a week where I've got other things
and
going on,
the week before. Yeah, you've played whole planets, or the week after you have to play something extremely delicate and very, you know, so it's juggling all of those different balls, having those things in the air,
mm-hmm.
juggling all of those styles, you know, Steve was saying, pops, kids shows, you know.
Yeah, I had a trumpet instructor at Interlochen, John Lindenau. He was a great guy. And he said he sort of felt that the Brandenburg was either a 2-week project or a 6-month project, that you either could sort of play it, you know, or you needed the time
to work
to put
it.
In. So, yeah.
Now, Karen, you're holding a natural trumpet.
Yeah.
Speaking of Baroque trumpet.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Could you play a few notes?
Well, can we just say that I got this out of the bottom of my locker and I probably haven't played it in 10 years. Until yesterday.
And it has no valves.
Yeah. So I just thought it would be interesting to demonstrate that, you know, the trumpet, so before 17, like, valves were invented in the late 1700s, generally, mid-1700s, and like the Haydn trumpet concerto was the first instrument for a chromatic, first piece for a chromatic trumpet.
And that was a keyed bugle, wasn't it?
Keyed bugle, yeah. But that was sort of the beginning of the trumpet being able to play notes beyond what I'm about to try to play. So in the works that composers were writing, the composer only had those notes to choose from, you know? So they had limited, as we get higher in the range, of the notes become closer together on the harmonic series, and so that's why the works of Bach and Handel are so high, because that's where the notes, you can play melodies and it becomes like a scale. So,
and if you're playing a different key, you have to put in a different lead pipe.
I have this bag full of pipes and crooks, and you know, that allows me to play in different keys, but I have to remove the crook and remove the pipe and get the longer one or the shorter one so that it adjusts the length of the instrument so that it can play in the different key. Of course, now we just put down the valves and that adjusts the length of the pipe, and that's how we play the different notes anyway.
And you can adjust the tuning with slides.
That too.
With your triggers and so forth. Yeah. So it's much easier. So why do people play natural trumpets?
Well, you know, I used to play it quite a lot back in when I was still living in Montreal and a student at McGill. I started studying it there, and I personally feel like it's really been an interesting pedagogical experience for me. Once a year, every 2 years, I usually bring it up for my university students and do a little class on because to understand, I like knowing that. For example, when we were playing a Beethoven symphony, which notes would have sounded good and which notes would not have sounded good, you know? This instrument is in the key of D right now. So if I was to play an example, for example, of the last movement of Beethoven 5, let's say that, it will be in the wrong key. I apologize to those of you that have, it's not in C right now, it'll be in D. But anyway. See, the note, that note, which is the fourth note of the scale, it's high, but the instrument, we would have had to adjust with our lips, the historical trumpet players, or now these modern, quote-unquote modern natural trumpets have holes which allow us to play a little more in tune for the modern ear. But in that time, the listeners and the audience would have been used to the instruments having that sort of funky intonation. That's why it's nice to have valves and slides. Try to play a little more in tune.
And in some cases, the quality of the notes, for instance, on a natural horn, are uneven in tone quality.
Oh, totally, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, anyway.
Well, let's hear another example of high trumpet playing. Maynard Ferguson.
Oh, yeah.
You mentioned earlier that when you're playing in the orchestra nowadays, we play so many Pops concerts. Last year we did, or was it 2 years ago, we did West Side Story. We brought in a lead trumpet player for that because it's crazy high writing.
Yeah.
So could you maybe just talk a little bit about how you have to change your approach to playing a more commercial style in terms of equipment, style, whatever comes into your head, you know, basically?
Okay, well... It's great to have these experts in the style of playing commercial playing Broadway style shows to be able to come in and help us out. I love playing that music, and it's an absolute gas to get to play that stuff. But it takes a toll on your chops, on your lips. Anyway, but so in order to prepare and. If there's something coming up, I do have different B-flat trumpets or C trumpets that are maybe lighter. A lot of commercial players will play a lighter, smaller bore.
Shallower mouthpiece.
So adjusting the equipment so that the sound is a little bit brighter, comes a little quicker.
Yeah, I think the equipment provides a little bit more compression.
Yeah.
In the sound and in the air
to
help.
And we adjust our style of playing. So... When we like, say, for example, on the first concert this year playing Mahler 4, you know, we use sort of bigger C trumpets with deeper mouthpieces, bigger mouthpieces to sort of get a richer sound and more with lots of overtones in the sound. And, you know, for a pop show, I'll use like a shallower mouthpiece, brighter, or something that will have a little more zip or zing in the sound.
In terms of chops, I mean, I remember about 25, 30 years ago, every trumpet player I knew had a book called Double High C in 37 Weeks.
Oh.
Which I suppose
Let's
is useful.
Let's get that book.
Well, it's interesting that you mentioned Maynard because I tried something different. I didn't have that book, but when I lived in Montreal, I did move to Verdun, which is where Maynard lived when he was in Montreal. And I thought maybe just living there might just, I might
give
sort
you,
of maybe
your,
drink the water or it might happen. It didn't work out, but yeah, it was worth a try.
But in terms of, I mean, basic trumpet playing, does that sort of stuff ruin you for the main repertoire? I mean, is there a limit to the range that you have to sort of cover and go no farther without hurting yourself?
Well, in theory, no.
I mean, some people can do it, right?
And some people just have a can do it,
tough
and
time.
The rest of us have a tough time.
Yeah, I've sort of had it explained to me by somebody who's really, really great at it that it's not some kind of mythical, magical thing, that it can be approached. And I think also it goes to perhaps a little bit of your upbringing and what you sort of your initial sounds in your ear. And I think that has a huge impact on it. You know, we talked about Herseth earlier. And that he could turn sort of that sound on from time to time. And I think it goes to what he grew up listening to. And I sort of believe the similar for me, that what I grew up listening to, I can sort of head in that direction easier than I could perhaps head in, you know, Doc Severinsen or Maynard's direction, because that wasn't sort of my initial oral concept.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the people who perhaps specialize or feel that it's something that's maybe not quite as difficult for them. I think it's something that they grew up listening to. And I think the ear has a huge impact in what you can sort of attain initially on the instrument.
I think that's a great point because I've always believed that the first sound is kind of your basic sound. And it's very difficult to change your basic sound. I mean, you can use different equipment and so forth. This is my own experience on tuba. You know, I started playing B-flat, Boosey and Hawkes tubas, which have a fairly thick, heavy sound, English sound. And I've always liked that sound. And I admire the German sound a lot, and I admire the American sound a lot. But I feel that my basic sound has always been that original sound, and it's sometimes tough to change that. Would you, has that been your experience, or has your sound changed dramatically?
I love what you guys are saying. I totally agree with what you're saying. I think it's a similar concept, what you're exposed to.
Mm-hmm.
And because I had a late start, I didn't study the trumpet until my second year university, blah, blah, blah. And so I feel like I was very influenced by the concept of the sound of my teachers, the Montreal Symphony players at that time.
Great models, though.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, and fantastic.
Yeah, yeah. Like just... Yeah, just I got so lucky. But I also played in jazz bands or big bands in high school, in university in Regina, where I did my undergrad, and also at McGill. So just knowing that, I would love to be more prolific at that in that style, but anyway.
Well, here's another style. You know, orchestral music internationally has always been sort of many different styles and sounds. I think it's becoming a bit more homogeneous. But let's hear a sample of German brass playing.
Thank you.
How do you feel that the Germans approach trumpet playing? I mean, they use a lot of different kinds of equipment for a start, don't they? Use a lot of rotary valve trumpets.
Yeah.
How do you describe their approach to brass playing?
Well, I think it's interesting what you said, again, orally. You know, we use the rotary valve, and our former music director, Pinka Zuckerman, we did a lot of repertoire with him that we used rotary valves on. Mm-hmm. And again, what you were saying about your sort of initial oral sound, we used those rotary valves, and again, even with pops, you know, we can change the equipment, but sort of you're always sort of looking for yourself in that equipment. And we are, you know, we do try to change the sound and sort of head in a direction, you know, as we would have heard with the German brass. Mm-hmm. And we sort of attempt to head in that direction, but it's very hard to sort of rid yourself of your own individual sound in your head. You know,
I think perhaps articulation has something to do with it, the way they articulate. I remember Jim Thompson doing a clinic here a few years back, and he made a C trumpet sound like a D trumpet.
Just because of the way he changes
articulation.
Yeah, he's all about, yeah, he talks about, and that the language they speak and the pronunciation of the syllables influences mm-hmm. how they play. The French use a brighter, harder, crisper T, and the German it's heavier, thicker. Mm-hmm. Has to do with their consonants and pronunciation within their language. Yeah, yeah.
So it's much more complicated than we thought when we first started talking about this.
Oh my God, it's so hard.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I can't believe.
I don't know where to start.
Yeah.
Well, thanks very much for joining me today, and we'll see how the rest of the season pans out. We've got some more big stuff coming up: Wagner, Strauss. Anything you're looking forward to in particular?
Oh man, everything.
Yeah, I sort of look forward to the variety. I think, you know, it's very interesting talking about all these different styles because it's sort of what we look forward to is changing styles from week to week. I think that's part of the excitement of playing in a busy and great orchestra with great colleagues and great, you know, guest artists, is that we get to attempt and you know, push ourselves at all these
different styles. We love playing the pop shows because they're always super demanding and tons of fun stuff to play. Plus we have great ballets often. We're playing Sleeping Beauty this year with a guest ballet company. So that's mm-hmm. always something really, that's great music, something to look forward to, lots of stuff, fun stuff for the brass.
I mean, to me, it's interesting. I mean, I've played under all the conductors now that have been here since day one, and they've all been slightly different, and the orchestra changes, the style changes, and I feel now that the brass section can sort of play the way we want to play. Do you agree with that?
Well, I think, you know, just like any other musician, you try to adjust the sound to the what's being requested from the podium and the concept of, I mean, I only came here when Trevor Pinnock was around, so mm-hmm. this is only my third real influence in this orchestra, and for sure they each have their own individual concept, and even the way they change the setup of the orchestra right now, I find it's really influencing that this general sound and colors are being approached with a different idea.
So it's nice to be able to be flexible for different conductors, different requirements, different repertoire and so forth.
Like Steve was saying, it's part of the challenge.
Yeah,
it's part of the fun.
I think we like to, you know, as much as we want to feel the freedom to do whatever we want, perhaps as musicians, we do want a strong idea, I think, mm-hmm. from the conductor of what they want to hear. But then we also like being given the trust from that position to be able to attempt to, you know, head in that direction by our own, you know, our own training and our own way, hopefully.
It's nice when it fits together. I remember, I think Herseth actually said when Schulte went to Chicago, he said he plays the kind of music that we like, the way we like to play it. So that's a marriage made in heaven, you know?
Absolutely.
I guess that's why they're so famous.
Yeah.
But yeah. We're very excited to have Alexander Shelley as our new music director, and we'll hope to see how things pan out in the future.
Yeah.
Thanks very much for coming in.
Thank you.
Thank you, Nick.
For having us, Nick. Yeah.
It's very, very kind.
This has been a National Arts Center podcast produced in Ottawa by NAC New Media. Send us your comments and questions. Email us at nacpodcasts@gmail.com. Visit the podcast section of the iTunes store, where you can rate and comment on this podcast. We love to hear from you. Remember, you can find more great NAC podcasts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Center.